So I would like to begin my presentation. Before that, I would like to read this inspiring statement from Swami Vivekananda ji. Stand up and fight. Not one step back, that is the idea. Fight it out, whatever comes. Let the stars move from the spheres. Let the whole world stand against us. Death means only a change in garment. What of it? Thus fight. You gain nothing by becoming cowards. Taking a step backward, you do not avoid any misfortune. Swami Vivekananda. Is my voice clear, Ajit?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
So in this presentation, we'll be mainly talking about the history taking part. And before going to history taking part, we will discuss the basics of the anatomy and physiology of the vertigo. Then we will talk about different types of dizziness, like this vertigo, unsteadiness, lightheadedness, and then its onset, duration, progression, provoking factors, associated symptoms, and personal family past history. As you know, students, the history taking part in the evaluation of dizzy patient is very, very important. In majority of the cases, up to 90% of the cases, you should be able to diagnose the cause of vertigo only with the history taking. So history taking is of paramount importance, but that should be very, very systematic. So if we take a systematic history, we will not miss any point. Otherwise, vertigo is a very, very sort of very complex subject. And the data of vertigo. Hello, Ajit?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes. So this topic is very wide, and you can understand that in one session it's difficult to cover each and every aspect of the vertigo. So in this session we'll be talking about anatomy and physiology and history taking part. So we should know how the body maintains its posture. So for maintenance of the posture, sensory input it goes to the brain, and these sensory inputs, they consist of not only of vestibular equilibrium and spatial awareness, rotation and linear movement, but even visual inputs also, they go to the brain. And in addition to that, proprioceptive touch and this pressure and vibrations, they also go to the brain. And all these sensory information will go to the brain stem and the cerebellum and even the cerebrum. So you can see all the information, they are going to the cerebellum. So in the brain, integration of these input that occurs. So cerebellum will coordinate and regulate the posture, movement, and the balance. And cerebral cortex will contribute higher level thinking and memory. And brainstem will integrate and source the sensory information. From here, then certain motor outputs comes. And after integrating all this information, brainstem will take certain decisions, and they are passed in the form of this vestibular ocular reflex. And you understand this vestibular ocular reflex generates the nystagmus, and it helps in fixing the gaze. Then the motor impulses to control the eye movements. So when we are moving our head, at that time eye also they move, and that tries to bring the image of the any object on the retina. And the motor impulses, they also help in maintaining the posture. So this is the membranous labyrinth you can see, and the main part of this utricle and the saccule, and you can see this in this utricle, the three semicircular canals they open, and these semicircular canals they have the ampullated and the non-ampullated ends. So with the five openings they communicate with the utricle. So the largest semicircular canal is the posterior one, that is the largest one. And the shortest is the lateral semicircular. And then you can see that the utricle and saccule, they communicate with each other with the help of this utriculosaccular duct. And this utriculosaccular duct, it continues as the endolymphatic duct. And its distal part, you can see, dilates, and that is called endolymphatic sac. So this utricle, saccule, and semicircular canals, they are the main parts of maintaining the balance. This utricle and saccule, they send the linear acceleration movement and deceleration movement and tilting and the gravity that is picked up by this. And these utricle and saccule, they have this maculae, that is the vestibular receptors for this linear and tilting and the gravity sensation. You can see the structure of this crista. So this is crista embolus. On this we can see the hair cells, and there are two type of hair. These hairs are kinocilium and the stereocilia, and these hair sort of processes, they are embedded in the cupula. So this entire thing, this is the cupula, and this is the part of the endolymph. So this cupula will move along with the movement of the endolymph. So if this movement of the endolymph is towards the cupula, towards the utricle, that is called utriculopital, and in lateral submucosal canal, that will be excitatory. In vertical canals, towards the utriculopital movement, that is inhibitory. And this you can see the autolytic organs, which are situated in the utricle and the saccule. And you can see these two type of cells, these flask-shaped type cells. They are type 1 hair cells, and these are type 2 hair cells, cylindrical cells. And here also we can see this kinocilium and stereocilia, and then we can see that they are embedded in this gelatinous meshwork, and then we can see these otoconias. And in cases of benign corneal positional vertigo, these otoconias, they move from here their normal position, and they enter into the semicircular canal. The most common semicircular canal that is affected is the posterior semicircular canals. Students, if you have any question, you can ask me, I won't mind. You can interrupt me anytime. So that will rather make the session very interactive. Otherwise, it will become a little monotonous. If you have any question, you can interrupt me, you can ask me. Now, we should know a little bit about these vestibular pathways. So from these vestibular receptors, the information they will see the area of the scarpa ganglion, and its afferent they will go to the vestibular receptors, and efferent they will go to the vestibular nuclei. The efferent from this scarpa ganglion that forms the vestibular part of the vestibular cochlear nerve. You can see here they do not go directly onto the vestibular nuclei, but some of them fibers they are going even to the cerebellum. So the vestibular receptors are directly communicating with the cerebellum, you can see. And as you know, we have four vestibular nuclei: superior, lateral, medial, and inferior. Inferior mainly it will communicate with the vestibulospinal tract and vestibulocervical tract, and the medial will communicate with the opposite side of this vestibule, you can see here. And then the superior, the projections they are made in the upper part of the brain, and mainly you can see this medial longitudinal bundle. So they provide communication between the vestibular nuclei and the cranial nuclei of the cranial nerves, which supply to the extraocular muscles, like this nuclei of this cranial third oculomotor, abducens, sixth, ending, fourth, trochlear and oculomotor nerves. So they will help in generating the nystagmus. And these three semicircular canals, you can see that lateral, that will be sensing the horizontal movements, like these rotatory movements, and these vertical canals, as I told you, they will be judging this to and fro movement of the body and side by movement of the body. And they are situated 90 degree angles at each other, orthogonal position. Now again, this you can see this mainly these vestibular cells. So if the movement it occurs away from the kinocilium, that is inhibitory, and if they are moving towards the kinocilium, that is excitatory. In the resting stage also, you can see that these cells, they are quite active and they are continuously firing this action potentials. And towards the kinocilium, you can see that is excitatory. So nystagmus will be patient will feel vertigo if there is imbalance between these two activities. If there is balance between the two sides of the vestibular, this firing, patient will not feel vertigo. But if there is any difference, any that misbalance is there, then the patient will feel vertigo. So if the vestibular is stimulated or excitatory, patient will have vertigo. And if one side of the vestibule is inhibitory, again that will lead to vertigo. Now students, can you tell me the condition in which vestibule is excited, is stimulated? Residents, tell me the condition in which vestibule will be stimulated or excitation will occur. Any example? The students, can residents, can you hear me? Ajit?
Yes.
Yes. Can they tell me disease in which there will occur stimulation of the labyrinth? I am not able to hear.
Caloric stimulation, hot water or
I am not able to hear. It's certainly echo is coming. Benign paroxysmal position vertigo. Okay, the affected side of the labyrinth that will be stimulated, and that makes the patient giddy. Can you give some other example? Where excitation will occur in serious labyrinthitis.
Stimulation like hot water or cold water, and
serious labyrinthitis also will occur excitation, and that will make the patient giddy again. And can you give me the example of the paresis or the inhibition of this labyrinth? In this condition, there occurs this inhibition of the labyrinth. Yes, residents. Which condition? I'm not able to hear. In cases of acoustic neuroma, okay, they will occur inhibition, and that will make the, again the patient will feel little imbalance and unsteadiness. So that we should understand that in some of the conditions there occur inhibition, and in some of the conditions there occurs stimulation. So whether it is inhibition or stimulation, and patient will feel vertigo. And if the both the sides of the labyrinth they are dead, then what will happen? Residents, the both the sides of the labyrinth they are dead, they are not working, then what the patient will feel? Will the patient have vertigo? The both the sides of the labyrinth they are dead, if they are not working, they are not functioning, patient will not feel any vertigo. Even if the fistula is there, and if you perform the fistula test, even during that time also there will not be any vertigo or giddiness. You cannot see, will not be able to see any movement of the eye. No nystagmus will be there. Now the neural connections which contribute to the vertigo, this vestibulospinal tract, sensation that the body is being hurled or pulled in space, leading to the unsteadiness. Then vestibulo-ocular, it will generate the nystagmus. And the vestibular autonomic, that is the part of the limbic system, and they will cause these vegetative symptoms in the form of this nausea, vomiting, perspiration, tachycardia. So all they occur during cases of vertigo due to this autonomic limbic system. So vestibular, there are connection between the vestibular nuclei and the reticular system. And vertigo, as you know, it's a very, very common complaint. Some of the studies they say that in primary care patients, the primary care physician, they see roughly about 50% of their patients, they are having the complaint of this imbalance or vertigo or lightheadedness. In our ENT OPD or neurologist OPD also, they say that up to 10 to 20% of the patients, they have these complaints. So it's a very, very common complaint, and in elderly, that is the most common complaint. If the patient is above the age of 60-65, their most common complaint is unsteadiness, vertigo, giddiness, lightheadedness. So the description, whether which type of patient is feeling giddy, that is very important. So whether the patient is having vertigo, that means patient will have false sense of motion. So this false sense of motion or rotate, that can be in the form of rotation, spinning or whirling, that is vertigo. The patient simply feel unsteadiness or the loss of balance. Now this vertigo, usually the cause lies in the labyrinth definitely. And if the patient is feeling only unsteadiness or loss of balance, disequilibrium, usually the cause lies in the brain. So these patients, they should be examined, they should be seen by the neurologist to rule out any neurological causes. Lightheadedness, in these patients can feel, have different sort of feeling. They can have as if the body is floating, they can have feel as if the head is there, they are feeling fullness in the head or out of the body sensation. So these patients, they have usually psychiatric causes and emotional disturbance they have. So they should, these patients, they should be seen by psychiatrist. Syncope is the near faint. So once they faint, that will become syncope. And the feeling that occurs before the syncope, before the faint, that is presyncope. Now these presyncope patients, they should be seen by the cardiologist, because most of these causes, they lie to, they are related with this cardiovascular disorders. And usually we divide these patients of vertigo into two groups. Either they can have these peripheral vestibular disorders or the central vestibular disorders. The peripheral vestibular disorders, they include the pathology of the labyrinth and the vestibular nerve. Whereas the central vestibular disorders, they include the pathology of the vestibular nuclei, the brain stem, cerebellum, and the cerebrum, mainly the basal ganglia. So this is very important, this unhurried and detailed history. So if you are taking the history in a proper way, that needs some time. That will require minimum 30 minutes that will require. In the busy OPD, sometime what we do, we simply prescribe the patient this vertigo and stroziron, and that's it. And fortunately, majority of these patients, they respond to that, but that is not the right way to treat the patient. So if the you are busy, very busy in the OPD, then these patients, they can be called, they can be given appointment, and history should be taken in a very, very proper way. And that often provides enough information for the diagnosis. Again, I will repeat, in 90% of cases, only just on the basis of history, we can diagnose the cause of vertigo. Then the examination will include complete thorough ear, nose and throat examination, otoscopic examination, the vestibular and CNS examination. The CNS examination will include mainly the cranial nerves, motor system, sensory system, that should be examined. Then the central vestibular disease is life-threatening or produce severe neurological sequelae. So these patients, they should be seen by the neurologist. And in normal patients also, vertigo can occur. Yes, residents, can you tell me there are some condition in which in normal patients vertigo can occur? Yes, students. So these are the psychophysiological diseases. Okay, this motion sickness, these patients, they are absolutely all right, but they are little more, become more sensitive to unnatural movements. So because they become more sensitive to unnatural movements, and that can lead to this motion sickness. And the psychiatric disorder patients, otherwise they do not have any organic lesion. So they are absolutely normal, but even anxiety, panic, depression, and phobic behavior, they can lead to vertigo. But otherwise these patients, they are normal. They don't have any organic lesion. Similarly, motion sickness also, they do not have any motion, any organic lesion. So these patients, motion sickness patients, they can be very well managed with the help of physiotherapy. Then there are certain red flag indicators, and these patients, they need immediate consultation from the ENT surgeon if there is sudden new unilateral development or progression of the hearing loss. So the patients who develop unilateral gradually progressive hearing loss, or the patients who develop sudden hearing loss, these patients, they should be thoroughly evaluated. And if need be, they should be sent for MRI. So that will rule out the cerebellopontine angle tumors, mainly this acousteneuroma. The incapacitating dizziness for more than 6 weeks. So if the dizziness is not responding to the medical treatment, again, these patients, they should be thoroughly investigated. And the severe tinnitus that is not responding to any treatment, again, that can occur in cases of CP angle tumors. And these patients, again, they need MRI evaluation. And any neurological symptoms or signs, if there are any motor deficit or sensory deficit is there, then again, these patients, they should be evaluated by the neurologist. Discharging ears, as you know, discharging ears, the most common causes that can lead to intracranial complications are this acute otitis media and the chronic subcutaneous media. The acute otitis media that can lead to acute labyrinthitis, and sometimes it can lead to even brain abscess also. Mainly with the cerebellar abscess, these patients they can have vertigo. Similarly, the CSM with cholesteatoma, these patients they can develop labyrinthitis and the cerebellar abscess. So both these conditions patients they will have vertigo, and as you know, both these patients they need immediate treatment. So these patients they should be immediately managed by the ENT surgeons. Again, ear pain that will occur in cases of acute subcutaneous otitis media, and patient can have fever, and side by side the patient is have vertigo, that indicates that the patient is developing labyrinthitis. So these patients again they should be immediately managed, because initially this labyrinthitis will be serious labyrinthitis, and that is reversible. So if give a complete course of antibiotics, we can save the labyrinth. And if the antibiotics they are not instituted, they are not started in time, that can lead to subcutaneous labyrinthitis. And this subcutaneous labyrinthitis is totally irreversible. The damage is irreversible, and the patient's labyrinth will become dead. And the progressive unsteadiness or falls, these patients again they should be evaluated by the neurologist. And the extreme cases of social, occupational, emotional, these patients they should be seen by the psychiatrist. Then there are certain other neurological conditions which need urgent treatment, and mainly they are the cerebrovascular strokes, hemorrhage, and infarcts. These patients they should be immediately referred to the neurologist, and we can save certain lives. And the main distinguishing features between this central and peripheral vertigo, you can see the sudden onset with rapid progression. So these peripheral vertigo patients, they will have sudden, they can have sudden onset, but with the passage of time, they improve. Second day is always little better than the first day. Third day is always better than the second day. But if the patient is have neurological cerebrovascular strokes, with the passage of time, their condition, they can deteriorate. So they can rapidly progressive conditions and deterioration in the patient condition. And the patient cannot walk and stand even with the support. So if the patient cannot walk and stand even with the support, it means patient is having some neurological disorders. So these patients, again, they should be immediately sent to the neurologist. And the conditions which are not life-threatening, but again, they need immediate treatment. There's a trauma to the labyrinth or the temporal bone. So mainly the labyrinth will be affected because of the structure of the temporal bone. Bacterial labyrinthitis, as I told you initially, to start with, patient will have serious labyrinthitis, and that is a reversible condition. If we start antibiotics, we can save the labyrinth. And with the antibiotics, they're not given in time, it will convert into the suppurative labyrinthitis, so the purulent labyrinthitis. And that will lead to irreversible damage to the labyrinth. Then the otosyphilis, as you know, it's a medical condition that can be totally cured. So patient, that's VDL, that should be done. The perilymphatic fistula also, if they are managed in time, you can save the patient's hearing. Otherwise, with the passage of time, the ear can become dead in case of perilymphatic fistula. So these perilymphatic fistulas, they should be managed in time. So these conditions, you can see, they are not life-threatening, but if treatment is instituted in time, we can save the patient's labyrinth. Otherwise, patient's labyrinth can become dead. And I was talking about the history. So history should be taken in a very, very proper way, and no point should be missed. So whether the patient is having lightheadedness, so either the patient is having vertigo, means patient has true feeling of movements and sensation, and usually it is in the form of spinning or the whirling sensation, and the cause lies in the vestibule definitely. And if the patient is having disequilibrium unsteadiness, the cause lies in the CNS. And if there is presyncope, means the feeling that occurs just before syncope. And rest of the feelings, rest of the explanation, rest of the description of the dizziness, that will fall in the category of lightheadedness. So they can have a floating sort of floating sensation, or the flying sensation, or the a little fullness in the head, or a little darkness of the feeling, little weakness, all those conditions, they will fall in this lightheadedness. Then whether the vertigo is continuous or episodic, that is again very important, because the causes of episodic vertigo, they are different, and the causes of continuous vertigo, they are different. And if the episodes, they are episodic in nature, then we should ask the patient the duration of their episodes. So the episodes duration lasts for seconds. The best example is benign prone position vertigo. So in benign prone position vertigo, these episodes, they last only just for a couple of seconds. But these couple of seconds, they are really frustrating for the patients. They will feel as if they are going to die. The feeling is very, very sort of as if they are just at the bed, at the door of death, rather they feel. So even few seconds, couple of seconds, they look like minutes. So usually they will say that bahu chakkar aavache, but if you ask repeatedly, then they will tell you the exact the duration of the vertigo. Then if the episode lasts for minutes and hours, that indicates two conditions, the minutes we should keep in mind, and the migraine. Days and months, the acute vestibular neuritis, the vertigo can last for days, and in the months, again, that happens in the cases of central vertigo, or if there's some psychiatric condition, they can have, these patients, they can have the chronic vertigo. Then the effect of the head movements. In cases of peripheral vertigo, any head movement that will worsen the vertigo. Whereas in central vertigo, there is no change in the, if the head is moved. In the specific position that induces vertigo. Again, the best example is this benign prone position vertigo. And in this little, when the patients roll in the bed, left lateral or right lateral, immediately patient becomes giddy. So usually these patients, they have the vertigo on the right rolling conditions, right rolling positions. So particular position that can induce vertigo. Then the preceding history of trauma, that is again very important. We need each and every patient, we should take the history of this trauma. It can be the physical accidental trauma, it can be barotrauma, or even certain surgical procedures, they can make the patient giddy. Any ear surgery in that way can make the patient giddy. Then any history of medicines, that also we should take. Those certain antibiotics, hypotensive agents, hyperglycemic agents, they can induce, they can give rise to vertigo, and the medicines which are used for this cardiac arrhythmias and CNS disorders, again, they can also make the patient giddy. So this history of medicines is very important, that we should not forget. Each and every patient, we should ask history of medicines. In certain medical conditions, they can also lead to vertigo, like this hypothyroidism, diabetes mellitus, anemia, autoimmune disease, hypoperfusion of the brain, that will lead to presyncope from the postural hypotension, then the cardiac arrhythmias, then psychogenic disorders that we should not forget, anxiety and panic disorders, and agoraphobia, it can lead to vertigo. Then the other, they are triggering agents, which are specific for the specific conditions, like the stimuli. It can be in the form of noise, sound. It can be formed in the form of pressure or the movements rolling onto the bed. Again, the sound and pressure, the best example is fistula, is perilymphatic fistula, labyrinthine fistula, and deficiency of this PSM cerebral canal. All these conditions, they can lead, if the patient is exposed to this noise and any pressure change, that can make the patient giddy. If these patients, if they, let us take the example of this this fistula, perilymphatic fistula, or the labyrinthine fistula, or this deficiency or dehiscence of this PSM cerebral canal, if these patients, they put little strain while defecation, they can become giddy. Or if the patient, they perform the Valsalva maneuver, again they can feel giddy. If they are simply blowing their nose, they can make the patient giddy. So the stimuli, they are important, they can exactly direct us towards the cause of this vertigo. Then the associated and the concomitant symptoms, they are very important. Ear discharge, again, we can understand the discharge means most common cause is chronic subarachnoiditis media, and if the patient is having cholecystoma, these patients, they can develop vertigo, and the cause will be labyrinthitis or cerebellar abscess. Pain, in cases of acute subarachnoiditis media, initially patient will have pain. So this acute subarachnoiditis media patient, they can develop sometimes labyrinthitis, and even occasionally they can lead to even cerebellar abscess also. Hearing loss. So in all these conditions, hearing loss will be there, but the best example of hearing loss is the Meniere's disease and the acoustic neuroma. In acoustic neuroma, patient will have unilateral, gradually progressive sensorineural hearing loss, whereas in Meniere's, patient will have the triad of hearing loss that will be fluctuating in the tinnitus and the vertigo and fullness in the ear. Tinnitus, again, it can occur in cases of Meniere's as well as in cases of acoustic neuroma. Ear fullness, that will indicate again towards the Meniere's disease. In the diplopia and vision loss, they indicate some certain neurological causes. And if diplopia and vision loss is there, then we should refer this patient to the neurologist. Multiple sclerosis, that can lead to certain hearing loss, and the patient can have certain vertigo also. Headache. In cases of brain abscess, patient can have headache. If the headache is there, actually the most, some of the studies, they have shown that the most common cause of vertigo is migraine. So that we should not forget, that we should always keep in mind. If the patient is having repeated episodes of headache, then we should rule out the migraine, because migraine associated vertigo is very common. Rather, they say that it is the most common cause of vertigo. And if the patient is having fever, neck rigidity, and all those things, then meningitis, that should be ruled out, because again, this meningitis, again, it can lead to labyrinthitis. Then any motor deficit and the sensory deficit, again, this patient, they should be seen by the neurologist. And sweating, dyspnea, and palpitation, that can occur in cases of Meniere's disease and acute osteomyelitis. And that is due to this, that we saw that autonomic nervous system and this our reticular system, they communicate with that, and that can lead to this dyspnea, sweating, and the palpitation. Then this, we talk about the type can be whirling or imbalance, disequilibrium, lightheadedness, and the presyncope. And the imbalance, some patients, they say that they feel imbalance in the head. And that most, then in those patients, we should remember is ototoxicity and acoustic neuroma. So the patients of acoustic neuroma and ototoxicity, they will feel imbalance in the head. And if the patient feel imbalance in the legs, the cause lies in the cerebellum or in the posterior column disorders or weakness of the legs. So this posterior column, they carry this proprioceptive sensation to the brain. So if they are affected, then again the patient will feel imbalance in the legs. The best example is stapes dorsalis patient, they will feel imbalance in the leg. And the presyncope is nothing but this before fainting or losing consciousness, and this occurs due to the reduction of the blood flow to the entire brain, and that will make the patient giddy, weak, and patient will look paler. And the postural hypertension, cardiac dysrhythmias, all these conditions, they can lead to presyncope. The lightheadedness, again, as I told you, the cause lies in the due to psychiatric disorders and emotional disturbances they can lead to. So these patients, they have fear of falling. They feel having the swimming sensation, and the cause is their psychiatric and emotional. Now the chronic continuous dizziness. Depression can lead to this chronic continuous dizziness. Again, these patients, they should be seen by psychiatrist. Then even the stress can also evoke the bout of vertigo, and the most common cause is Meniere's disease. Then onset, duration, progression. So the events that led to vertigo, incidence of vertigo, they are very important. So the preceding history of URI, that we will find in cases of acute vestibular neuritis. And sometimes we find this condition in this aspergillus, you can see in immunosuppressive patients, and the patients who are on long course of antibiotics and steroids and advanced age and the diabetes and stress. So these patients, they can develop this herpes zoster oticus. Students, can you tell me what is this herpes zoster oticus? What will happen in this? What is another name?
Facial nerve palsy with it is also called Ramsden syndrome. Peripheral facial nerve palsy with erythematous maculopapular rush on the external part of the ear.
External part of which part of the ear?
Ear pinna.
Posterior part. Posterior part of the external ear that is affected. not the anterior part, but the posterior. You can see the herpes vesicles in the posterior part of the external canal, in the region of the postauricular sulcus, and in the region of the mastoid process. So there we can see, and these patients, they will have facial palsy also. Then the initial severe symptoms lessen over days. So if the symptoms gradually becomes less and lesser, that indicates peripheral vestibular disorders. And if the with the passage of time the symptoms they become severe, that indicates neurological conditions. So if the patient is having acute vestibular neuritis, suppurative labyrinthitis, the meningeal disease, with the passage of time the severity of vertigo will decrease. Whereas in neurological causes, otherwise it can, the severity can increase. The initial severe symptoms do not lessen over the days, but they deteriorate. And that indicates cerebrovascular strokes. Then the duration of episodes that I mentioned, whether the duration lasts for a couple of seconds or minutes, but the longer the vertigo, greater the chances of central cause. And the vertigo upon awakening in the morning, so mostly these peripheral vestibular disorder patients you will see, they will develop vertigo in the early morning when they get up from the bed. Like this Meniere's disease and this BPPV patients, they will have episodes in the early morning. And the typical duration, again, you can see this table. If the episodes last for a couple of seconds, the cause is benign positional vertigo. If it lasts for minutes, 2 hours, the transient ischemic attack and the Meniere's disease and the migraine. If it lasts for days, this single prolonged episodes of vertigo, the main cause is vestibular neuritis, suppurative labyrinthitis, strokes, and multiple sclerosis. And if it lasts for weeks and months, the cause is psychogenic. And we talked about the provoking factors. These provoking factors, they are so specific that if the patient is giving some specific provoking factors, immediately we can know the cause. Like in this BPP, what will happen? Patient will develop vertigo on positional changing of the turning over in the bed, whether in the left side or the right side, or bending over the waist, and then straightening up, and then hyperextending the neck. All these they indicate towards the BPPV. And we should keep in mind that is the most common condition, but hyperextending neck that can lead to vertigo, and that can occur due to this cherry malformations. So cherry malformations also they can lead to vertigo and hyperextending of the neck. Then if the food triggers are there, stress and improper sleep, and if the patient is having episodes of headache, we should think about migraine. Migraine we should keep in mind, again I will repeat, deliberately I am repeating, because it is among the most common cause of vertigo. Then perilymphatic fissula, direct blows, scuba driving, these are the causes, heavy weight bearing and straining. These conditions, they can lead to perilymphatic fissula. And sneezing affected here. And if the patient is having a perilymphatic fissula, if they lie or if their affected ear is down, then these patients they will feel more giddy, more dizzy. And the Tullio's phenomenon, exposure to the loud sounds that can make the patient giddy, and that occurs again will occur in the perilymphatic fissula, labyrinthine fissula, in the descent of superior semicircular canal, in cases of syphilis. And the psychological, social stressors, psychiatric, again, that we should not forget. Again, this similar. Then the associated symptoms, ear pain, discharge, hearing loss, already we have discussed. This nausea and vomiting usually occurs in cases of Meniere's disease and in cases of acute vestibular neuritis. In the patients of benign prognostic positional vertigo, usually they do not have nausea and vomiting. And if there's any sensory or motor deficit, that will indicate towards the CNS causes. Patient can feel weakness, dysarthria, vision disorders, paresthesias, altered level of consciousness, ataxia. All these conditions, they indicate towards the cerebrovascular strokes, multiple sclerosis, and brain tumors. Headache, again, migraine, that we should keep in mind. And this headache will be throbbing. It will be unilateral. And some of the patients, they have aura also. And usually these migraine patients, they will give the history of this photophobia and phonophobia. Then the history of any medications, trauma, exposure to the toxin that we have discussed. Then the vascular risk factor, they are very important in particularly the elderly patients and who are having the cerebrovascular strokes. So these vascular risk factors, they must be inquired whether the patient is having history of any smoking, diabetes, hypertension, and hyperlipidemia. All these, if these vascular risk factors are there, then we must think about these cerebrovascular strokes. Heredity, that can be seen in cases of migraine as well as in cerebrovascular strokes. And the treatment of the hypertension causes. As such, the hypertension is a very, very rare cause of vertigo, but its treatment, the medicines which are given for hypertension, they can lead to vertigo. So the treatment of hypertension causes more imbalance than the hypertension itself, which per se is an extremely rare cause of balance problem. Now, there are certain conditions, common conditions, and we should know their characteristic features. Suppurative labyrinthitis, that can be caused by acute suppurativitis media, chronic suppurativitis media of the cholesteatoma, and even meningitis. So if the patient in this patient will be having the findings of middle ear infections in the form of pain, discharge, deafness, meningitis. If the patient is in meningitis, they will have headache, fever, and neck rigidity. Then in vestibular neuritis, patient will have prolonged episode of vertigo, and patient will not have any history of hearing loss. Patient will not have any history of tinnitus. So except severe vertigo, vomiting, nausea, patient will not have any other complaint. And on examination, we can see only the nystagmus, vestibular jerk nystagmus, that we can see on examination. There will not be any other finding. Similarly, in case of benign position of vertigo, patient will have only the transient episodes. There will not be any other history of ear symptom, like the tinnitus or the hearing loss. Hearing will be totally normal in cases of benign position of vertigo. Cholesteatoma, that can be very easily diagnosed. So the patient is having cholesteatoma, usually this patient, they will give the history of all smelling ear discharge, and on ear microexamination, easily we can see the cholesteatoma. So this cholesteatoma, it can lead to intraocular complications in the form of brain abscess. We are talking about vertigo, so the most common that we should remember is this cerebellar abscess and the suppurative labyrinthitis. Herpes orticus, already Remsen syndrome we discussed. Meniere's, we know, the perilymphatic fistula. Now this perilymphatic fistula, it can mimic Meniere's disease. It can mimic any condition rather. It can mimic even the BPPV. So this is the condition that we should keep in mind, and this common dizziness of variable duration after trauma, surgery, excessive straining, spontaneous and profound congenital, and episode of dizziness triggered by pressure. It can mimic any condition. Similarly, migraine also, it can mimic any condition. It can mimic BPPV. It can mimic Meniere's disease. So these perilymphatic fistula patients and these migraine patients, that we should keep in mind, because they can mimic any condition of the or any cause of this vertigo. Then the TIA stroke, usually these patients, they will have some motor and sensory deficit. Isolated cases of vertigo in TIA, they are exceedingly rare. Migraine, we talked about. In multiple sclerosis, patient can have motor, again, that sensory deafness, sensory deficits. Patient, they can present with sudden. Patient, they can have sudden onset of facial paralysis, sudden onset of blindness. So these patients, then the cervical vertigo, it's again common condition. If the patient feel move any this cervical movement, that triggers the vertigo. And the vertigo that triggered by the somatosensory input from the head and neck regions. And the drug-induced vertigo, that can open to adverse reaction of the drug and the psychological condition that we talked about. So we can, for the sake of history taking, we can divide the vertigo into two groups, single episode, that too prolonged. And the best example is the acute vestibular neuritis and the recurrent episodes. The best example is the benign position of vertigo and Meniere's. So these recurrent attacks, we can divide further into with the hearing loss and without hearing loss. With hearing loss, the condition is recurrent attacks of episodes of vertigo with hearing loss. We should remember the Meniere's disease and acoustic neuroma. Whereas without hearing loss, recurrent attacks, we should remember the BPPV. Then BPPV, there will not be any hearing loss. So that brings end of this session. If there is any question, I would love to answer your questions, students. You can ask me.
Sir, thank you very much. Sir, thank you very much for the wonderful session, sir. And I think the take home message for everyone from this session is that a proper history and examination cannot substitute the diagnosis of vertigo. No matter how much investigation we do, but the proper history and the examination, that is very, very, very important for diagnosing a case of vertigo. As was evident from your talk, that you emphasize maximum on history taking, sir.
You're very right, Ajit. So main component of evaluation in cases of vertigo is history taking, because history taking will take some time, whereas examination you can finish within 5-10 minutes. Examination won't take much time. It is only the history part that is important, and examination equally that is important, but it will not take much time. Ajit is very right.
And sir, regarding the VMG, sir, vestibular nystagmogram, video
or video nystagmogram, is it very important in diagnosing, or again, this part is, I mean, more important? Most of the people, they feel that it's just a research tool and it won't much help in the diagnosis. We can simply confirm, because most of the diagnosis they are made on the history taken on clinical examination. So that's it, because all those tests that we perform with this for this video nystagmography, so we perform those tests, and those tests, they can be performed even without the facility of video nystagmography.
Yes.
Like this head shaking test and this Dick Sahlbeck test, all those tests we can perform without that also.
Yes, sir.
But it's a very good research tool.
Yes, sir.
Any other question from student side? I will appreciate if the students, they have any question.
No questions.
So what I feel that we can have a series of these lectures. So this time we talked only about the anatomy, physiology, and history taking. In the next series, we can keep the examination part. In the examination part, I will cover each and every aspect of the examination.
Yes, sir, but it was a very vast topic.
Only clinical examination we'll be talking about. We will not go for these gadgets, these modern art of, so they are not usually required. So we'll be talking only about the clinical examination. So if you perform clinical examination in a proper way, again, in the majority of the cases, we can know the not only the cause of vertigo, but the site of pathology also we can know.
Yes, sir, we definitely plan it also.
Yes.
Thank you, Dr. Bansal. It was a pleasure listening to you, and I've had the opportunity to interact with you in the earlier days of Adani, and you are no newcomer to this place. I know a lot of batches you've taught EAT over the years, and it was a wonderful talk, and you were actually our opening batsman for the series of guest lectures. So, it was a wonderful talk, and again, I would like to thank you on behalf of Adani Institute for sparing your valuable time and sharing your experience with us. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much for this kind opportunity.
Thank you, sir. Thank you from all of us. Thank you.
Sir, I should thank for this great honor and this for great opportunity.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Sir, I am closing this meeting now.
Okay. Yes. You can end the session.